They are, you know, we got two veterans and two groupies. And, you know, they are two younger women. They are very good. They are committed and they put all they had into learning this dance. And I want you guys to welcome them and smile at them because the two little babies, you know, this is their first dance, you know. We don't want them to melt up here. they know that if anything falls off, they just dance right over it. Doesn't matter what it is. Praise the Lord. So I just want you guys to welcome them and enjoy.
a happy day. And when you're in the house of the Lord, remember, where two or three are gathered together in His name, Jesus is right there in the middle. That makes a happy day. Aren't you glad that God created smiles and joy and laughter and happiness? That was God's idea. He says that laughter is actually good medicine. A cheerful heart is good medicine because it releases those endorphins, which are the healers that He put into our body. Scientists are just now figuring that out. But He did that for us a long time ago. And I've always told people, don't be afraid. I have people say, if I go to the doctor, if I take medicine, isn't that saying I don't have faith? No. No, it's not saying you don't have faith. Stop and think for a minute. Who created everything there is out of nothing, spoken into existence? Jesus did. It all was from God. And He has given us resources. Man didn't think those things up. God had already thought them up. Man is just figuring out how to use them now. So no, don't be afraid to go to a doctor. Sometimes God uses doctors. Sometimes God inspires doctors to give you the right medication. But God can also instantly heal you. So always remember that. God is the author of joy and happiness and laughter also. He says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. I always like to read you something kind of funny. I think you'll like this one today, so listen up. A minister parked his car in a no parking zone in a large city because he was short on time and he couldn't find a place, a space that was legal with a meter on it. Then he put a note under his windshield wiper that read, I circled the block 10 times. If I don't park here, I'll miss my appointment. And then he put a little quote from the Bible, forgive us our trespasses. When he returned, he found a citation from a police officer under his, with a note on it. I've circled this block for 10 years. If I don't give you a ticket, I'll lose my job. And then he quoted the scripture, lead us not into temptation. Sitting for a while, stand up, find your Bibles. We're going to hold them up. We're going to honor the Word of God. So help me out here. All right, hold them up. We honor the Word of God. We believe in the Word of God. We teach the Word of God in every class and in our messages and in our Joshua house. So say it with all of your heart. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess, my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same, never, 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 I will never be the same, in Jesus' name. David, it's unanimous. They all believe it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Take your Bibles. Turn to the Gospel of Luke. Gospel of Luke. And chapter 15. I have fretted over this one because the scripture I want to read is long. And I knew I wouldn't have a long time to do it. So I'm not going to read the whole thing. But we'll probably talk about the whole thing. Find Luke chapter 15. And Just a little footnote. I wanted to start on verse 11 reading, but I'm not going to. You should when you get a chance to squeeze. But I want you right now to go down to verse 25, and we're going to read to the end of the chapter, verse 25 through 32. 25 through 32, chapter 15. One more time, chapter 15, verses 25 through 32. This is what the Word of God says. The older son was in the field, and when he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him, "What is going on? Your brother has come home," he replied, "and your father has killed the fatted calf because he was back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and he refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him but he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you, and I've never disobeyed your orders, yet you never even gave a young goat so that I could have a celebration with my friends. But when this son of yours, who squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you were always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is now alive again. He was lost and is found." Let's bow our heads. Lord, we thank you today for the Word of God, the awesome, inspired Word of God. We thank you for this passage, which is in a red letter edition, all red, which means it's the actual voice and teaching of Jesus himself. And I know that Jesus is the Word. It says in the Gospels, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That means Jesus is the Word. But I also know, Lord, that he went and he left his Spirit with us to teach us the Word. And when anything was said by Jesus, it was so important for us to hear that he made certain it was in the Word of God, clear and plain, so we can read it and we can learn from it. Now teach us today an important lesson, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this is part of a great scripture. That part I just read is the part that is usually not read. And the other is. The first part is the story of the prodigal son. And I'm just going to very quickly tell you what that story is, and then we're going to go on to the end. That is a story where there was a father that was very wealthy, had a big farm, big ranch, whatever you want to call it. And he had two sons. Of course, one is older and one is younger. And the younger son comes to his dad. I would imagine that he had thought about this quite a bit, because his dad could have just kicked him out when he came and asked him for his part of the money right now. He could have kicked him out. He could have disowned him. He could have said, "I'll have nothing to do with you. And he could have called him a lot of names. But the story is as much about the father as it is the sons. The story tells us what the father is like, what God is like. Instead, he went and he sold half of what he owed and gave it to the son and let him take it. Now the son had big plans. He was going to get away from this little Jewish town and Jewish farm and part of the Jewish people. He wanted to get away from that with all their rules and regulations. He was tired of having to be in at a certain time, and he was just tired of all this stuff that he felt like people were putting on him. So it says in the Bible that he went to a far country. He wanted to get away and go to just a place that he had never been, and maybe a place that didn't have any rules. A place where he could do his own thing. And a place where he wouldn't be checked up on every time he did. And so he took his money, and I believe he bought probably a really nice horse Back then, they didn't have cars. Well, they had Mustangs, but they didn't have cars. Bought a Mustang, and it was all decked out with a saddle with poly silver gold. He had the nicest outfits. All the other guys and all the other kids were jealous of him when he left. And he was going to a far country. He was getting away from all the stuff he had learned. And all the other kids were saying, "Oh man, if I could do that, that'd be so awesome." And it says that he went away to a far land, and there he just did his own thing. He had parties. He had friends out the yin yang. You can have a lot of friends when you're buying the drugs, when you're buying the booze, whenever you're paying for the girls. And you can have a lot of friends that come and call you friend, but are they really friends? Some time went by and he wasted his money on riotous living, the scripture said. And then when his money ran out, there happened to be a famine in the town, in the area, where there were jobs were hard to find. And he went out and tried to find work. Well, his friends weren't going to help him with any money. They just disappeared. They were like snow on a hot day. It just gone. They evaporated. That's the way a lot of friends are, because they're not your real friends. They're a bunch of people that are taking advantage of you. Guys, listen to me. If you hear nothing else today, hear this. When you get out of Joshua House, or when you go on pass, know this. What you used to have to steal money to buy will be offered to you at no charge by somebody, maybe somebody that doesn't even know you. And I guarantee you, your friends want to ensnare you again. Satan uses drugs and all those things to ensnare us and to pull us down. Yeah. Don't fall for that. Because the moment you get back and you taste those drugs one more time, or you get back and you dip that drink, you're going to go right back to the bottom of that hole that you were in. And it's not worth it. It isn't worth it. This young guy took off in a blaze of glory, but all of a sudden, this young guy was destitute. And he couldn't find anybody to give it up. Found one job. Worst job that a Jewish boy could ever get, because he had been told how bad and nasty pigs and swine were. He was feeding the pigs. And I'm going to tell you something, that's not a very nice job. I one time went back to Illinois to stay with one of the guys that was in college. I went through Illinois back to Pennsylvania and to their little farmhouse, and they had a lot of pigs and cows and all kinds of little animals that, on their farm. It was a real nice little farm, but it was all snow-covered, icy, because the snow would melt in the day, and then it would freeze up, and it was the slickest knot on the doorknob. You couldn't stand up hardly. And I remember seeing icicles hanging down that were 10 and 12 feet long on that house and that big around. It was just something else. And I went back there, and one day I got the job of slopping the hogs. And I had seen this bucket that was sitting in the kitchen. They ate like five meals a day. I actually gained weight then, a lot of weight, when I was there, because they ate all the time. But anyway, everything, eggs and blood, it went in there. Anything that they didn't eat went in there. Anything just nasty went in there. And I thought that was like a garbage pail, until I found out that it was kind of a grayish, greenish, kind of like a liquid, but kind of like a solid. And that was the slop bucket I found out, and that was what I was to take out and feed the pigs. Nasty, stinking, smelling stuff, and it was a big thing. And I remember going up that hill, and it was slick, man. I didn't want to dump that stuff on me. But I also remember when I walked in that barn, I still remember to this day, the young pigs, when they smelt that slop, started squealing and hollering and jumping up on the side of what they call the pig pen, and they were ready for it. And I had to be the one to dump it in. I got it, but I was going to do a good job. But me and that side's going like this. I got up there and started dumping that stuff in. I remember them slopping it all over me. Stunk, oh my goodness. And when I poured it out, it took a long time for me to ever eat bacon or pork chops again. Those pigs were all standing up, and that slop ran down into their noses and their eyes and all that. They were licking it off each other. Oh, geez, that nasty. That was horrible. He got a job having to feed the stinking pigs that he was told to stay away from. That's the only job he could get. And he got so hungry that he was ready to eat what he was feeding the pigs. I'm going to tell you, you got to be hungry to do that. Really hungry. But that's what Satan does to us. He promises us the world. You're going to have friends, you're going to have money, you're going to do this, you're going to do that, you're not going to have any rules. It's going to be wonderful. Next thing you know, your friends are gone, and you're down in the bottom of the pit in the hog slop, ready to eat it. He sat there feeling sorry for himself, and then he came to his, the Bible says, a light went off his head. He came to his senses. And when the light went off, he said to himself, you know what? The hired servants back at the farm, my dad's farm, have it better than this. I'll go back home and I'll say to my dad, Dad, I'm not worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your hired servants. I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. He practiced his speech because he didn't know what he was looking at. Because the story really hinges not on the boy as much as it hinges on the dad. Because if the dad doesn't accept him, it means nothing. What would his dad do? Would his dad say, get out of here. You betrayed me. You betrayed the family. You didn't listen to us. Well, he could have done that very easily. Or he could have said, you're not going to ever come in here. But the scripture says the boy practices and practices and practices, not knowing what he was going to find, because the important thing is, what does the father say? And it says when he was a long way off, he saw his father. And his father saw him. And his father ran to meet him. The father waited for him to make the decision to come. And then the father ran as fast as he could down that hill till he got to his son. His son tried to say it. He said, Dad, I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. And he couldn't get any more out. The father grabbed him and hugged him and loved him, loved on him, and began to scream at the top of his voice to his servants, quick, quick, bring. Go and kill that fatted calf and bring it. We're going to have a celebration. My son has come home. Get shoes for his feet. Get a robe for him to wear. Get a ring for his finger, a signet ring, which proves he's part of the family. Do that quickly. We're going to have a celebration. We're going to have a party. My son that was lost is alive. My son which was dead is alive. My son which was lost has come home. Celebrate. We're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate. And they begin right then to have a party. And they got the instruments playing. People were singing and they were dancing and they were having joy. And they killed that fatted calf and they were having a feast. Well, the older boy was out working. And that's what I read to you. The son has said in verse 21 that he said, Father, I've sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. That's all he got out. But it says in verse 25, meanwhile, the older brother was in the field. He was working. And when he came near the house, he says to himself, whoa, 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 wait a minute. What's all this music playing for? It sounded to me like there's a party or something going, and then he got closer and he heard them dancing. So he called one of the servants over and he asked him, "What in the world is going on?" And the servant said this, "Your brother has come home." And the older son says, "What? Yes," he said, "he's come home, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." And the older brother became angry, and he refused to go in. So his father came out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you, and I have never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never even killed a goat so I could celebrate with my friends." I'll stop right there. He was mad. He was upset. He was mad. Well, stop and think for a minute. The younger son went out and just did everything that he did. But it's like us. We have a free will that God gave us. God created us in His image. God created us, and we're born a little beautiful baby, and we begin to grow up, and we sin. We have a decision to make, live for God or live for ourselves, and we choose to live for ourselves. As years go by, we have opportunities with church and with people inviting us and people talking to us to turn our life around, but many times we don't. And then the first thing we know, we get ourselves in a mess. You know, guys, we started Joshua House because we saw some people get into a mess. We saw guys get into a mess. And they found it. They got themselves into a hole they couldn't get out of. And our hearts were breaking for them. We were doing a program with another place in town. They do a great job with men. And we worked with them for 8 years. But we needed more beds because there were a lot more men than 12 or 13 that they were housing. So we started Joshua House. That's just been about 12 years ago now. We did it because our heart was breaking, because Satan was destroying not only people's lives, but he was destroying relationships with wives and with girlfriends, and horribly splitting kids away and moms and dads away. It was a bad thing. And Satan was stealing everything that men had. And men were having to go and steal to support their habits, which was hurting the community. And then eventually, many of them were thrown into jail or even into prison. Our hearts were breaking. So we said, "We want those guys. We want those guys. We want to help those guys. We want to be part of God's plan of pulling them out of that deep mire of clay, out of that pit where something can happen." It's a good thing. But you know, some folks, when we made that decision to do that, got upset and mad. We had folks that actually got mad and left the church. We had folks that left the church upset because they said, "We've been here all these years, and we've always been faithful. We've paid our tithes, and we..." I could go down the litany of stuff. "And here you're treating these guys that have messed up big time like royalty. It's not right!" And one day it hit me. Gee, I could put their names in this book. I could. Folks, you that are faithful Christians, can I say something to you? Thank you for you. I thank God every day for you. If it wasn't for your faithfulness, if you weren't faithful in attending church, you weren't faithful in doing worship, you weren't faithful in paying your tithes, you weren't faithful in serving in classes and in ministries, we couldn't do any of this. We're not forgetting you. We want to honor you. But God reminds us There is a lost world out there who desperately need Jesus. And we can't come and sit and soak in the scriptures of things every week in the church and then go out and do nothing. There are people who desperately need the Lord that we come in contact with, that we need to talk to, and we need to love on. We had two funerals this week. One on Friday night, a wonderful lady. One on Saturday, these flowers represent their family, the Benjamin family, and Reiko Benjamin was baptized. She was saved here. She was baptized here. She's gone through a long, long illness. Wonderful lady. Wonderful lady. Wonderful family. And we got the opportunity yesterday to minister to them by having the service for them and loving on them. Part of our job, folks, is to love on people. When people are discouraged, when people are down, we need to lift them up with an encouraging word or maybe an encouraging hug. I hugged so many people yesterday, I couldn't believe it. They wanted to hug me. They needed a hug. Well, I can provide hugs. I'll tell you what, Pastor Elliott taught me how to hug. He was a pastor of hugs. Remember that. And he loved on people. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful things. Folks, you are important. You are needed. Without you, we could not do what we're doing. He was mad. He was upset. The older brother was angry. He said, I'm not going to go in there and celebrate this guy that was with prostitutes and was with all the other rats in the area and was doing drugs and dealing drugs and drunk. I mean, he was so mad. And he says, look at me. Look at all the years that I've been slaving for you. And you never once killed a young goat for my friends so I could celebrate. But this son of yours, this son, you didn't even want to call him his brother, this son of yours, your son, not my brother, your son, squandered your property with prostitutes. He comes home and you kill a fatty cat for him. Can you hear the anger and see the fumes coming out of him? But here's what the Father said. The Father represents God the Father. Don't you remember this? It's about the Father. What does the Father say? He says, my son, you're always with me. Everything I have is yours. The scripture says we become sons of God, joint heirs with Jesus. Did you get that? We are joint heirs with Jesus. That means that everything Jesus created from nothing, everything he spoke into existence, all the gold, all the silver, all the plutonium, all of the oil, all of the natural gas, and you could go on and on and on. It all belongs to us. The reason we don't have it is because we don't pray sometimes and let the Lord know what our needs are. Oh, he knows our needs, but he wants to hear us ask. A loving father will take care of his kids. He said, everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate. We had to celebrate and we had to be glad. Because this brother of yours, and he's putting that right back onto his son. He's not my son only, he's your brother. This brother of yours was dead. And now he's alive again. He was lost. And he's now found. We have a lot of events that are outreach events. I know we do, more than any other church. We do things to get people in off of the street, but the scripture told us to go to the highways and byways. And we do that literally. We take food to the hungry and food for the needy. We provide clothes for anyone that needs clothes, even sleeping bags and tents. When we have the money, we give them out. Well, why do we do that? Because our mission is to get outside these four walls. Why do we do the big 4th of July picnic and bring in somebody that everybody wants to hear sing? Why do we do the celebration of heroes? Why do we do the picnic down the park and invite every single person there is to come? Last year, we went down the fence line where they had homes built out of tents, and we got into every single tent and invited them to come over and have a barbecue dinner. That won't happen in many places. I've been to barbecues that churches have had, picnics, and I thought there was an armed guard there because the trustees or somebody else were lined up to make sure that nobody that wasn't on the official list got to come in. What do? We go out and scream and holler and invite everybody in. Why do we do that? Well, number one, they're hungry. They're hungry for food, but before they're going to listen to the gospel, you got to meet their hunger pains in their stomach. That's right. And you know, when you love on them, a lot of those walls that they have built up against religion kind of fall down. And then you can share with them the love of Jesus. The story, yes, is about the two sons. The one that messed up big time but got straightened out. And the one that was always doing the right thing but had a bad, stinking attitude. And it was about the Father. The Father is God. The Father waits until he sees us coming over the hill. Then he runs to meet us. The Holy Spirit speaks to our heart. He calls us. He said, come, come, come. Julie, I remember the day that Mike gave his heart to the Lord. You know, Mike, that day I felt like I got saved all over again. There was so much joy and peace in my heart. And I look at you and I see how you're ministering back to these guys, this ministry. And I just say, look what God does. Look what God does. It's an awesome thing. So here's my challenge, folks. There is an unlimited supply of sinners outside these church walls. Okay? They desperately need to be loved on and welcomed. And I want you to invite them to come here to church. They're going to hear great music. They're going to hear a sermon. They're going to be a part of a great fellowship. And we're going to love on them. Let's stand together and we'll sing. While Randy comes, this is part of the service where we have our prayer requests up on the screen usually, and there they are. We have a lot of prayer requests. If you're here today and you need to be anointed with oil or prayed for, if you would like to kneel at an altar, if you would like to ask the Lord into your heart, there'd be prayer partners up here. We'd love to have you come as we sing. Thank you. important time we have in the church for power is prayer. I invite you to come if you want something changed in your life. God can do it. You may have tried and failed, but God will do it. You come if you have a need. Being here today. If you're here and you don't know the Lord, boy, I tell you what, you need Him. Any one of us would be glad to share with you how to receive Christ. It's so simple. Just to ask the Lord to forgive your sins. Tell Jesus you know that He's your Lord and Savior and invite Him into your heart and you'll be saved. Very simple. God has done the hard part by allowing Jesus to go to the cross and shed His blood for you, but now you have to do your part, and that is accept Jesus as your Savior. If you'd like to pray with somebody, we're always available to pray with you. If you're here and you have another need of any kind, we would love to talk with you. Remember that. All right, we've got Roy, we have someone else here. Come. So when we dismiss today, because some are still praying, I'm going to ask you to go out quietly into the lobby, then you can talk all you want, but let them pray. All right, Randy, dismiss us with a good song. All right. Thank you, Lord, for this day.